All right. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, wherever you may be. Thank you for joining us. Another episode of Catching Up with Jacob, and he's back across the Atlantic. Jacob Prash, how are you this evening?
Here we are again. Wonderful to be with you all. I am well in Jesus.
Good to see you, brother. Welcome back. I've been off for a week, so welcome back. David Lister, you're not anywhere near where I am today, but welcome anyway.
Well, just across the ocean there, Pacific Ocean
Small
in
party.
Japan, very early in the morning. So
Good morning.
it's
Good
good to
morning.
be here.
You're in
That's
Japan
right.
at the moment,
Jay.
David?
What?
You're in Japan at the moment.
That's right.
Okay.
All right. Well, good morning, Jay. How are you today?
I'm well. Good to be here. Good to see everybody.
Good to have you on. And of course, it's also Saturday for Davey. How are you, Davey, in Australia?
Yeah, doing pretty good, thanks. And it's kind of good to know I'm not the only one up early. In fact, David's up earlier than I am.
Yeah, Saturday boys. Yeah, Saturday morning guys. Well, it's not quite Saturday, but it's getting there. Andy, how are you in
Okay,
Israel?
thank you. From greetings to everybody from Western Galilee.
Yeah, Memorial Israel. God bless you, brother. Welcome. Thanks for being with us. And we just
Okay.
want to welcome everyone who's watching live, those who will watch later. Welcome in the name of the Lord on what many people celebrate today, Good Friday. So it is a good Friday as we remember the Lord's death. Jacob, you got any announcements before we get started?
Just the usual for this time of year. All four Gospels and 1 Corinthians make it clear Jesus was not crucified on Good Friday, neither did he raise from the dead on Easter Sunday. But if this is when you commemorate it, we have no problem.
His death, his burial, his resurrection.
Amen.
And many Christians throughout the world this weekend. And it is a peculiar, interesting time because in the midst of all the dangers and all the problems in the world, yet we can serve and worship our Lord and remember his death and remember his death when we take communion, when we remember his death when we speak of him, and we remember his death until he comes. All right. David, you're in Japan at the moment, but you had some good times and ministering the gospel to people there. In Thailand, just very quick, how is that going?
Well, it went really, really good. The Lord was really gracious in giving me some very, very good teachings on difference between the Old Testament and New Testament. But it all comes out as the gospel, and they all want us to come back. They really are enjoying my talks, the singing from our Filipino missionaries, as well as the talks from Scott. So they really like having us over there. So we also went all the way down to Yala, which is real near the Malaysian border. Met a good pastor there, and would love to establish a relationship with him. He's in a Muslim area, and but he's got a good thriving church, and he knows that there's error out there. So
All right.
getting
Praise the
ready to
Lord.
meet new believer some believers here in Japan. So this should be interesting.
All right, brother. Thank you so much. And may the Lord's blessing be upon you. And thank you. And also for Scott, too.
Yeah.
He's been with you. And praise the Lord for
He's
him.
asleep. Or sits than me.
as most people are at this time in your area. So God bless you. We do appreciate you, David, sacrificing your time and being with us and sharing with us what's going on there. As well as we appreciate those who are watching live. And thank you. And we're going to be going on backstage after the episode and catching up. It's on all these different platforms, but we're going to leave YouTube and we're going to leave Facebook and we're going to be going over to backstage. And on backstage, we're going to be talking a lot about postmillennialism. What is it? Some of its dangers, some of the problems. What are the belief systems that are incorporated into postmillennialism? And you don't want to miss that. We did talk about preterism a few weeks ago, maybe like a month ago, maybe longer than now. Now it all conflicts together. But we will be talking about postmillennialism. You don't want to miss that. Elon, Jacob, David, Davey, Jay, all be sharing about postmillennialism And some of the warnings, it's not as all cracked up to be. But in the meantime, we will be catching up with you during these episodes. We've got a lot of information here. So why don't we start, Jacob, why don't we start with a hot take? Can we do that? Let's look at a hot take on what's going on. First of all, what's going on here in America with some of the presidents that were in New York, four presidents, three former, one current one. Let's say three of them were rubbing shoulders with the beautiful people, let's say, and one of them visiting a funeral, the family of a fallen police officer, and some of the stuff coming out of Baltimore and some of the stuff that they're trying to do to former President Trump. Jacob, we'll turn it over to you. What's your hot take of the week?
You know, Moriel, of course, we have affiliated churches in New York City, in Manhattan, and in Baltimore. And I was just a few weeks ago at both of them. And a few weeks from now, I'm due to be at both of them again. So I just happen to be in England when this stuff is happening. But Baltimore and New York are two cities where Moriel has affiliated congregations, and we have people. It is very interesting that Donald Trump was at the wake of a fallen police officer killed on the line of duty. The other three were at Radio City at a mega fundraiser, but they were being protested by pro-Palestinian demonstrators and hecklers. Mr. Biden and the Democrats, and let's face it, Mr. Biden is Mr. Biden. Obama is the real president, not Biden. He's just a figurehead. But we've talked about this. On one hand, they're in trouble in a swing state in Michigan that they need, where there's 200,000 Muslims. So they've got to try to placate these Muslims, but these Muslims and pro-Palestinians are against them because they are unable to divorce themselves from Israel. On the other hand, as we see with Alan Dershowitz and others, Democrats and the people in the Democratic Party who are Jewish are pulling away from Biden as well. So he's trying to keep both sides as friends, and he's making both sides opponents. He's not going to bring the pro-Palestinian vote with him, and the pro-Israel vote is something he's now losing. They're stuck. They're losing on both ends. That is what was really happening in New York. Yet, it's a game, it's political theater, and it's about money. And that's essentially what it was. What is really interesting is Alan Dershowitz did an interview with Israel News this week. And Mr. Dershowitz made it clear that in his opinion, and I agree with his opinion, the battle is not between Mr. Netanyahu and Mr. Biden. The battle is between the Biden administration, which is really the Obama administration with a facade, and Israel and Israel's existence. This very week in Oman, one of the three billionaires, you're talking about $11 billion between these three people at least. One of them is said to have $5 billion. He said there's going to be this week again, more October 7ths. And the policy of the Biden administration is to make sure that Hamas survives to carry it out. That's what it comes to. It's Biden versus Israel. At the same time, they can't say that directly. So the Democratic community has these anti-Israel elements and anti-Semitic elements, putting traditional Jewish members of the Democratic Party, which is at least three quarters of American Jews, into a state of political peril. Mr. Dershowitz is at least recognizing it and telling the truth. Others, like the son of Karl Rahner, what's his name? The kid who's always made, he's not a kid anymore, but he always made it on his father's name and reputation.
Rob Rahner,
correct. He has no real talent, in my opinion. It's just who his father was. He always had a job. He doesn't say anything. He's just pro-Biden, pro-Obama, anti-Trump. His Jewish identity doesn't seem to mean anything to him. And then you have the ones who are just being silly. On one hand, Mr. Spielberg is decrying the rise of anti-Semitism in the United States and in the Western world. At the same time, he's supporting the Biden administration. Yeah. The Jewish community finds itself in a dilemma. The traditional Jewish American community is becoming increasingly alienated from Israel. It's in a party with the Squad and with anti-Semites and enemies of Israel. And the Democratic Party leadership is stuck between the proverbial rock and a hard place. They're trying to placate the Muslim vote in a swing state, but it's not working. At the same time, they're trying to keep as many Jewish voters as they can and Jewish supporters as they can, but that's not working. They're being closed in on by both sides. By trying to be friends with both sides, they're making themselves the enemies of both sides. And that is what is happening this week politically.
Very good, Jacob. Thank you so much. And much more. By the way, did you hear the Baltimore mayor and his statements about making people afraid that are not of his color and race?
Can we play the clip?
You want to play the clip? It's very, very short. Let's see if I have it set up. Normally we don't play something on here, but let's see if we can do it. Hopefully there's audio, because there's often complaints that doesn't come through. Let's see. All right.
Very proud of my heritage and who I am and where I come from scares them, because me being on my position means that their way of thinking, their way of life, of being comfortable and suffering, and while everyone else suffers, is going to be at risk, and they should be afraid, because that's my purpose in life.
White people in Baltimore should be afraid. That's his purpose in life as the governor. Now, this is not a very educated or intelligent man, apparently. If he has an education, it's probably because of affirmative action. He's not obviously that intelligent, but he's racially motivated. He's a racist and he's embittered, saying that white people should be afraid. And it's his purpose to make them afraid, that they are living comfortably while other people are living in bad circumstances. And that's what he's saying. It's his purpose to make Caucasians afraid. The previous mayor of Baltimore, a Black woman, told the police to stand down when Black drug dealing gangs went through the slums of Baltimore and killed mainly Black people. The police chief, the prosecutors, they're all Black. Yet somehow they blamed white people for what took place when a criminal who died in police custody, even though some of the arresting officers were Black, and the senior police commanders were Black, they racialized it and they had these riots. I'd like to ask this mayor something, if I could ever ask him to his face. Of course, he wouldn't. Is it the fault of white people that this Black on Black crime and the murder rate in Baltimore has never been worse, never been more serious, and it's Blacks killing Blacks? Why are you blaming white people and saying they should be in fear? Yeah. For being comfortable while Blacks do this to each other? Is it the fault of white people that 3 out of 4 Black children are born out of wedlock in Baltimore, statistically predisposing them to winding up in the criminal justice system and to not finishing high school? Is that the fault of white people, or is it the fault of Black people, especially Black Democrats like yourself? This is the political machine of the late Elijah Cummings, a terrible man who's now dead. This is the political machine of a DA who's now under indictment, another Black woman. This is the political machine of the previous mayor who told the police to stand down when the city burned. This is what it is. They have this racist hatred where they are blind to the realities of what is happening in the Black community. That's nothing to do with white people, yet you have to blame white people for it, and say white people should be afraid for living comfortably or trying to feel comfortable. No, they should be afraid because they're living that way while other people suffer. Other people are suffering those things, not because of anything white people did. It's not due to systemic racism. It's due to the moral breakdown and the abandonment of traditional Afro-American base-based moral and family values. It's happening because of black-on-black crime. It's happening because of the school system designed to fail, and it's happening because of Democratic Party politicians, especially other blacks. That's why it's happening. That's what's happening. Yet he blames white people. This man is an ignoramus and a racist. But look who's interviewing him. Joy Reid, an ignoramus and a racist.
Yeah. It's pretty incredible to see what's going on in that. And I mean, if you didn't hear it, you couldn't believe it. If I told you about it, you probably couldn't believe it that a mayor actually said it. In fact, there was a meeting, and I read about it. It was a meeting of black mayors from the United States about the violence and about, of course, the theft and what's going on in their cities. And literally they come out and they blame the owners, the store owners, for the fact that this is, you know, things are going on and the owners need to be held accountable. Business owners need to be held accountable. I could not believe they wouldn't address the obvious issue that is the moral breakdown in society, especially in their cities, and they're allowed to do it. Jacob, when I was a kid, when I was younger, living in the States here in LA, had friends that were Hispanic, had friends that were black, friends that were Asians. And within the only ones within my friends, circle of friends, my black friends, they were the ones who had Christian parents. They were the ones who had grandparents that were Christians. Latinos, we didn't have a lot of Christian parents, mainly Catholic. In Asia, very little. But the black community had a lot of Christian parents and grandparents. I met them. And it seemed like within the last 30 years, there is no or very little Christian influence. If any, it's like T.D. Jakes or Creflo Dollar are their influence.
When you turn from Christ, what do you wind up with? John MacArthur made some true statements about Martin Luther King. Now, MacArthur made it clear he respects Martin Luther King as a social activist and admitted Martin Luther King was influenced by biblical principles. But he simply looked at what Martin Luther King said himself. Martin Luther King's own statements, not believing in a virgin birth or a literal resurrection, things of that nature. And he gets castigated at Moody Bible Institute by a speaker, by black clergy attacking him, calling him a racist, saying these things about Martin Luther King. All he did was quote Martin Luther King. Now, again, like myself, he had certain aberrations for Martin Luther King as a civil rights activist. He just said that his theological beliefs were not that of a born-again Christian or a Bible-believing. Yeah. He was theologically liberal. And he gets attacked for it. Black racism has overtaken white racism. Can you imagine if a white or Caucasian mayor made a statement like that, that black people need to be afraid? That's my heritage. I'm here to make them. Can you imagine?
There would be riots.
Unbelievable.
There would be riots for sure.
Why are people like Joy Reid allowed to be on the air? Why is there not a move to charge this mayor with hate crime? And it's a racial incitement.
Yeah, I can't imagine Al Sharpton not jumping in on this pretty soon. That's the quintessential, you know, looking for a lawsuit, looking for a fight. Anyway, Jacob, thanks for your hot take. Let's talk about something, I guess, less controversial, which is, according to a lot of people, which is war. All kidding aside, war has become money, has become power, has become absolutely. It is destructive in all fields and all things. But what's going on with this Ukraine, Russia, now it's become even more. Now the attacks are happening within each of their countries. Ukraine first, now the attacks in Russia. Last week, I wasn't here, but the concert hall, that side of the concert hall, that the explosions, the people inside that were shot. It was crazy. I watched some of these videos. I played one for you that it was at least the most. It wasn't as graphic, but they were literally picking off kids and young people with the shooters. And of course, ISIS takes responsibility for it. But Jacob, now that these attacks, drone attacks, you know, terrorist attacks within these countries, we're going to see just the next stage of the war, which is now going to be, you know, a more of a hot war with the NATO, with Poland, NATO, Russia, Finland, Sweden, because things are not ramping down.
And France,
saying in France, of course, Macron,
20,000 into Ukrainian turf. What you're saying is true because now something has happened. India is no longer buying Russian oil. It stopped last week. Second, this is compounded by the reduced refining capacity due to the Ukrainian drone strikes that have been obviously achieved with Western provided technology. The Ukrainians could not do this without the Americans, the British, the French, and the Germans, either technologically or financially. Also, the attacks on Sevastopol and on the Russian Black Sea fleet, they've lost four ships last week. Four. That's mini Pearl Harbor.
That's right.
And again, another attack on the Kerch Bridge. But the attacks on the by the drones on the oil refineries, at the same time India has stopped, we have seen a further plunge in the value of the ruble and a further increase in Russian inflation. Russia has high interest rates of about 16%. Yet, with interest rates that high, it's not bringing down the inflation rate. When you already have high interest rates and it's not affecting inflation, that is an economy that is having stagflation and is in trouble, serious trouble, on top of what is happening with the balance of trade and oil exports. Let's remember that Russia is an oil state. It doesn't have a lot of other things to export. Its weapons market has fallen out because people are seeing Russian weapons are not good quality. They've seen that in the demonstrated in the battles in the Ukraine. So Mr. Putin is getting under economic pressure. The war that had been a strategic war has now become more of an economic war, or at least an economic war as much as a strategic war. This is what's happening. And the ruble is going down. Bad news for their efforts to destabilize the dollar and make a replacement of the dollar with BRICS. Bad news for their balance of trade. They thought they could replace the lost oil sales to Europe by going to India and China. And now India is buying oil from the United States. India is actually buying crude from the United States, not from Russia.
Wow.
It's not a good situation. The value of the ruble has gone way down again this week. People have talked about how Russia's economy was not doing that bad and it was outperforming the West. Not when you look at the value of the ruble, the exchange rate, and not when you look at the depletion of Russian foreign currency reserves. Somebody has got to pay. Wars always make business. They're always create a boom. But sooner or later, somebody has to pick up the bill for it. And now Putin is realizing the bill has to be paid.
Yeah, no doubt. What's what do you hear over there, Andy, with regarding the Russia and Ukraine war? Because it's really interesting. When I was there, you have Ukrainian Jews, you have Russian Jews, and you have this sort of the separation due to the war. What do you hear most of what where you are?
No, I've not heard a lot actually. From I mean, most of people's attention is on Gaza. Yeah. And on what happens afterwards. I'm not saying that people don't talk about that, but I mean, the news media that I've been following, and nearly all of it's all about Gaza, what happens, will there be a war in the north? Well, will it escalate? And that's most of what everything's been concentrated on. I've not really seen a lot of stuff on the Russia situation. I mean, most of the time, we're not thinking about that too much because we've got our own enemies just across the just a few miles away. And and of course the relationship with the U.S., which has deteriorated somewhat.
Yeah, we'll get to that for sure. The Poland is just ramping up, buying up more and more equipment. They got cruise missiles. This is U.S. Congress approved for more $4 billion. So they bought some before. They got another approval for $4 billion for cruise missiles, medium range missiles, short range tactical missiles, which are the sidewinders. What do you guys think? David Lister, you've been, let's go to you. So we have been a little quiet today. And what do you think? Poland's ramping up. They know something's coming.
Well, instability everywhere. They're wanting missiles, but now they're very afraid of what Russia's going to be doing, and so they want to prepare, but I don't think Europe has the where they all to give them stuff. I think they're probably worried. Maybe they don't want to sell any missiles to them so they can keep them for themselves. So
yeah,
the whole world is becoming destabilized. And I think there was a report I read this week that CIA and the UK were involved with the Ukraine in the blowing up of that government hall that had killed 137 people. And that was the security director of Russia that said
interesting.
That.
Yeah.
And so if he's saying that, then that puts us all right on the precipices of World War.
You know, I was reading Victoria Nuland's farewell speech, you know, the queen of U.S. foreign policy, as she's been called, under the Obama administration. And of course, under Biden administration, she was more of an advisor. Victoria Nuland says she has she bragged about what's coming to Putin, and she has a present for him. She has a present for him. And then she obviously talks about that she retired and all the stuff she did from the 2013. She's definitely blamed for the stabilization of Ukraine going back to 2013 with John McCain. But now she retires. Now you have this provocation. Now, and I want to read something to you. This is from the London Times. Is it time to talk about the fall of Kiev? For quite a long time, the media would not touch, you know, how Ukraine is doing, and it's really bad. Jacob talked about how Russia's doing. Ukraine is absolutely obliterated. It's been used, unfortunately, by the Western. What's that?
It's devastated.
Oh, it is completely devastated. The London Times. It's time to talk about the fall of Kiev. They would not have published this 6 months ago, or 5 months ago, or 4 months ago. It is now being published. So we're heading toward what I believe it's just a no-win situation. No one is going to win this. And it's just going to, we're now in year two and a half, 3 years. It's going to go on and on. But this, they want to provoke this stuff. They really, really seem to want to provoke this war. Obviously, they got a lot to hide. And seemingly, you know, not connecting the two. But Jacob, what about the Baltimore Bridge that collapsed? You know, some journalists are saying this is like a 9/11 style attack. You know, I wouldn't put it that way, but some of them are saying that the speculations ramp up on whether or not this was accident, ship collision, result of cyber warfare. What do you think?
The ship did have another incident in Antwerp in Belgium some time ago, where it similarly could not control its engine. Its engines. Hence, there is a history of problems with that particular vessel. Was the seaworthiness of that vessel properly examined and reviewed after the repairs of whatever happened in Antwerp? That's one of the questions. Another question, of course, is it DEI? The ship was not under the control of its captain or its Indian crew or its Ukrainian
mastership. Yeah.
It was, when you're in harbor limits, you're under the control of pilots. But are those pilots proper pilots, or are they DEI pilots? that is another question. Yeah. That is another question. When you put unqualified people in, the Biden administration was notorious for this in the Pentagon. They had these women. It was just because they were feminist and they were black, putting them in key positions in the Pentagon where they knew nothing about the military. But they were there. Well, the Biden administration is great for this, and it's another question that needs to be answered. One of the things that crossed my mind, and then I found other Christians saying the same things, and many on the internet. Fort McHenry in Baltimore Harbor is where the national anthem, Star Spangled Banner, was composed by Francis Scott Key. And this happens the next day after Biden, Obama, and the British government, certainly Cameron, put the knife in Israel's back in the UN. If you don't know what happened, Barack Obama, not Biden, Barack Obama, the week before last, made a very low-key trip to London, went to number 10, met with the prime minister and probably with Cameron, and comes back. And right after that, America and Britain put the screws to Israel and the UN, calling for this unilateral, calling for this ceasefire. While at the same time, Hamas was issuing further statements that there's going to be more October 7th attacks. These statements came out of Oman. So Hamas is saying, we're going to do this again. We're going to attack Israel again. And Biden and Obama and Cameron want to make sure that they have the wherewithal to do it, that they'll be able to carry out their threats, because they do not want Israel to remove the existence of Hamas from Rafah. This kind of betrayal of Israel, literally taking the side of terrorists who says we're going to do it again. Yeah. This is how corrupt and evil Barack Obama is, who's the real puppet master on back of O'Biden. And of course, the British just go along with it. That is what happened. So when that bridge was hit the next day, the national anthem, if you're not familiar with the lyrics that written by Francis Scott Key, for whom the bridge is named, "Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light that our flag was still there, that America survived this bombardment by the British Navy and persevered." Okay.
That's right.
Well, some people see a symbolic meaning, saying it's a warning from God. Your flag's not going to still be there if you continue to curse Israel. And there are a number of Christians saying that on the internet, and I'm not sure they're completely wrong by any means. The same thought crossed my own mind.
Will this have any major economic impact, David?
Will it have an economic impact? Absolutely. Absolutely. In Baltimore.
Yeah.
I've been across that bridge a number of times. Lots of traffic during the evening rush hour and the morning rush hour.
Yeah.
Now they had a tunnel that is in the middle that takes a lot of traffic. And getting through Baltimore is going to be a nightmare. So for trucks, it's going to be a problem. I do believe that they're going to clear the channel so ships can move in and out. But ships have to offload the containers onto trucks. And so I think that's going to be a big problem for Baltimore. Loss of GDP, some are saying as much as $80 billion.
The ports of New York, Philadelphia, and Albany, New York can take up the slack temporarily as to where the ships can go until it's reopened. But rebuilding the bridge alone, they're estimating the overall cost will be $4 billion. $4 billion.
More.
I'm not talking about lost revenue. We're talking about the reconstruction cost.
Right.
$4 billion.
Yeah, so, you know, but all these ports are, even though they can take up some of the slack, the problem is they're already busy. Our economy is actually doing really well right now. And so the supply chain, everybody's getting so much in now. It's going to be quite the troubling to try to get your stuff. You could have another slowdown, not because the stuff's not here. It's just because they don't have the capability of picking up the slack, you know. It's and then rerouting all this costs more money. So the cost of goods and services, inflation will hurt because of this.
Another factor is handling hazmat materials. Not every facility can handle hazmat materials. Outfitted. It has to be a certain distance from high population areas. You know, it has to be in the outskirts of a city. You need special rail facilities to transport hazmat materials. It's really not that simple. One of the things that stuck out from what I saw was the idiocy. The senile, not just the senility, but the absolute idiocy of Biden saying he crossed that bridge many times when he would take the train from Wilmington.
I remember that, yeah.
There's no vehicular traffic only. The rail line is in the middle of Baltimore. The traditional Pennsylvania Railroad and the Baltimore Ohio Railroad, the two main rail lines, are further west. They're nowhere near that bridge. Except in Biden's delusional world of senility.
Oh boy. Yeah.
What a mess, isn't it? And of course, this is the thing where people begin to speculate, you know, was this an attack? Was this a cyber attack? Was this just an accident? And they go through all kinds of, you know, it was, you know, the perfect storm. Everything went, you know, right for the accident to happen. But at the same time, I can't get past this idea that the Synergy Marine Group, which was all into EDI stuff, which was crazy, right? On the one hand. On the other hand, they have connections to China, which the U.S. government has basically sanctions Chinese hackers because they're targeting infrastructure. I mean, the government says it straight out, they are targeting infrastructure. And then we have this hit. So I can't get it past my head that in a very real scenario, you know, just using just straight logic, you're warning about cyber attacks. You got all this stuff that's going on with China and Russia and attacks into Russia. And we're in the middle of, you know, a very difficult situation with, you know, what's going on in Israel, what's going on in Ukraine. Then the government says we're being targeted. Then this happens and Synergy Group has connections to the CCP. So whether or not they did it, I don't know. But you're right, Jacob. This is going to be heavy, heavy, and just happens to be on that day. You know, maybe God's trying to show us something and tell us something, because it just seems like we go straight into more godlessness, and I don't know what's going to take for people to realize what's going on in our country and the world. You have major leaders, you know, four presidents, three of them go with Lizzo and Stephen Colbert to a fundraiser, you know, to rub elbows with the beautiful people, right? Look at this, $500,000 per ticket for admission. If you want to take a picture with Biden, Obama, and Clinton, it's $100,000. And so a total approximately $25 million in total was raised at this event in New York. And of course, Clinton's hugging girls, Obama's hugging dudes. And, you know, Biden, I have no idea what he was doing, but the amount of flack that they got, the Manhattan, it's called the Flood Manhattan for Gaza protest. I mean, it wasn't just a few people, Jake. It was massive amount of people calling them Genocide Joe. Genocide Joe's got to go. This is about Palestine. This is about freeing Palestine. And of course, that's when the United Nations Security Council this week unanimously passed a resolution calling for the immediate ceasefire. And by the way, it was 14-0. The U.S. abstained. And they changed the wording from permanent to lasting. They want a lasting ceasefire, as it were, to maybe placate different sides. Netanyahu cancels the Israeli delegation going to the White House to discuss Rafah. You know, the U.S., the White House, Kirby doesn't know why they canceled it. This is like, well, we don't know why he's so upset.
I think they've actually rescinded that cancellation now. I read it.
They're going to send him anyway.
They're going to send them cancellation now,
Interesting. Yeah. Are they going to still discuss Rafah? Because that was
I don't know, but that they okay. I read a couple of hours before on Twitter on X. That had been actually changed, but that still doesn't mean that they're going to accede to Biden's demand. Of course, we're not. No.
Yeah, the demand for an unconditional release of all hostages taken during the October 7 attack. Jacob, we'll start with you. What does this mean? Because it looks like Lord Cameron...
The Israelis are expected to give up 700 murderers, terrorist murderers, in an unequal swap. That's what usually happens. That's what's going to happen now. Again, it takes no account of the fact that Hamas is saying... we're not going to stop attacking Israel. There's going to be more of these, and we're going to attack Christians. All that is ignored by the mainstream media. It's just Joe Obama making sure that Hamas has another day to fight again and carry out their threats. What happened in the UN and the Security Council this week is the United States and the United Kingdom sided with Russia and China against Israel. That's exactly what happened.
Yeah. Andy, you obviously you have ties to the UK, you have ties to, you know, obviously in Israel. First of all, let's start with Israel. What are the thoughts there in Israel regarding this? This is America not supporting Israel? Is that the general sentiment among people?
Well, you know, first of all, a very large proportion, I think it's nearly 90% of Israelis support Netanyahu's insistence on finishing off Hamas. Yeah. I mean, it's a huge majority of the people. So, we're not particularly thrilled with Joe Biden, are we? You know, I mean, from what I've been hearing, you know, we're getting the impression that we're not loved as much as we used to be, you know.
Right.
By the US. But I don't think people have ever had great expectations from Britain here, because Britain's record with Israel has never been really that good. I mean, they say they support Israel, but of course it's been very faint on the whole. You know, they've always tried to weasel out of things, of really giving wholehearted support here to us here, yeah. You know, from the UK. It's always been... You know, there's always been some knife in the back at some point or other, or something like that. But you know, and if Labour do get in the UK, yeah. then that's the end of that. You know, they're so anti-Semitic that it's.
Yeah, Lord Cameron has been threatening Israel to end arms sales unless it does what he and the State Department wants. That's really what it's at stake here.
Yes. I don't think that Israel buys a lot of stuff off the UK anyway.
About 53 million pounds.
Yeah, it's not a lot. I think because the UK did something similar years ago. I think it might have been the Yom Kippur War, where they put an embargo on tank parts and stuff for Israel. Because we still had things like Centurions and stuff like that, and quite a lot of British kit still.
Right.
And they stopped that. And I think that was a lesson learned by us anyway.
Yeah. It is. I mean, it's definitely not a lot, but it's definitely substantial. Is what I'm saying. It's not a lot, but it's substantial. I mean, otherwise it held no water to the threats. You know what I'm saying? Otherwise, it would. You know, Israel responded to that and say, "Hey, you know what? They didn't like what they did, but they don't want the UK to stop arms sales."
Yeah, and also there is this. I mean, I read about a month ago as well that they're. Israel is now, I think they're starting to work towards producing some of our own ordnance here, like, you know, tank shells.
Really?
Yeah, because we can't trust the supply from the US anymore.
That's true.
You just don't know, you know, if Biden gets in again, heaven forbid, you know, that'll be the end of, you know, I mean, it'll be the end of the US probably, but it will certainly be the end of Israel's relationship with the US. I mean, another 4 years of that.
You know, I've seen the protests. I've seen the protests in London. I've seen the protests up in Northern England and Southern England, and it's against Israel, obviously pro-Palestinians. Palestinians, and it's an insanity that the parliament, you know, parliamentary meltdown, you know, over this issue. You know, it's unreal. But it's not the only problem in the UK. Obviously, you have issues in Scotland. You have issues within, you know, obviously, in London with the parliamentary. Jacob, the Scottish law that's coming into, I guess it's this Monday, isn't it?
Yes.
On free speech, online free speech, and everything that's connected to free speech.
Much the same as what Trudeau achieved in Canada. Canada can, strictly speaking, no longer be considered to be a democratic country. Well, that will become true of, and it's true of Ireland already, in effect, in terms of free speech, at least. It will become
absolutely
true of Scotland as of Monday. You have a Muslim first minister of the Scottish National Party. Can you imagine a camel jockey with a kilt or whatever? who's pro-Palestinian, anti-Israel. And this law has established 1,000 locations where people can go as a place of free space if they feel oppressed or offended by something. They put these in things like sex shops, even, where you can go in and say you've been offended by something you saw or heard or someone told you, even conceivably inside of a private home. And the police are obligated to investigate. 1,000 reporting stations where anybody who's offended by something can go and the police will have to investigate. Criticism of sexual orientation, religious beliefs, anything of this nature. So if you're critical of Islam, if you're critical of a news item that I watched this week in Afghanistan, thanks to Mr. Biden, who put the Taliban back in power, I saw a 70-year-old man with a beard buy a 9-year-old girl from her parents. I saw another little girl bought by a 50-something-year-old man, buying little girls, you know, not even adolescent yet, and they were buying them. And of course, our prophet did this with Aisha, so what's the problem? Oh, I'm offended. All you need is one Muslim to say he's offended that you're saying this. And it's a basis of a police investigation, a criminal investigation that has custodial sentences potentially. It is the end of free speech in Scotland. It is the beginning of Sharia in Scotland. London has a Muslim mayor. Scotland has a first minister who is a Muslim. This has got to be God's judgment on the UK and on Scotland. It must be. And the law is unbelievable. In the United States, you see this Ketanji Brown woman who took a soft role on pedophiles as a judge, yet they let her become a Supreme Court justice. She's a disgusting human being, if you want to consider her to be anything, even being gracious. She's a reprehensible person, saying that the First Amendment is making it difficult to censor. And that was her complaint. Her complaint. Free speech is under attack everywhere. And this obviously is going to be used to target Christians. Then it is going to be
absolutely
to go after Israel and the Jews. It is the book of Daniel. We'll find no basis to charge Daniel with anything unless we do it on the basis of his God and his faith. They get these laws on the books that seem innocuous. They get these laws on the books flying under the radar screen. And once they're there, they are applied politically. They're not applied with a juridical reason, but with a political motive. And that is what you're seeing. It's the Islamization of Scotland. It is the destruction of democratic free speech. And it begins on Monday. Scotland will no longer be a democracy. It'll no longer have free speech. What Trudeau has done, what Vradica has done in Ireland, what's happened in Canada with Trudeau is now happening in Scotland with their Muslim first minister. And there's nothing going to stop it in the short term. Nothing.
Mm. Yeah, we spoke about Ireland here maybe 6 months ago, what they were doing with Christian teachers that were opposing LGBT. And obviously that ended up not very good to the teacher. They sided with the school that fired him. They had complaints. They can go into your house. They can find, you know, all they need to do is just suspicion. And they can go to your house, collect your phone, collect your laptop, collect any books. Same thing in Scotland. Canada has those three bills called the trifecta. For the sake of the children, Trudeau said, for the sake of protecting children, we're going to pass these laws, internet law, internet bill, in order to keep people from saying what they could say online. Now it's going to be it's severe. It's jail time. It's fines. And they're going to have to investigate things, and it's prosecutable. Man, this is becoming, you know, in America, it's not as quite yet, but if the Dems get their way, oh man. And of course this is appeasing all the leftist Marxists, but they don't do anything about what Islam and their extremism and the terrorism, which is, you know, Jacob brought it up earlier. They're calling for lone wolves attacks on Ramadan, to kill Christians, to kill Jews in the U.S. and Europe and in Israel, right? This is the gift during this time. And Ramadan, Easter, this is their gift, Purim, right? That they're all this connected feast during this time. ISIS says, you know, that we're going to have lone wolves attack. But out of this, you guys, I've never heard any politician from any country actually denounce this. Maybe I missed it. Maybe Lord Cameron is aware of this. Maybe Obama is aware of this and they're calling it a
Lord Heyman. Yes.
Yeah. 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 Maybe they are saying something, but it's nowhere to be found, you know, condemning these things. Because why? Well, as you could say, it's already bought, sold, and I think they might let this happen. They might let this happen because it might bode well for their agenda, especially with the pro-Palestinian vote that they wanted to have here in the United States. So, Andy, any thoughts on this? ISIS is calling for more lone wolves attack, and they're saying it's got to be during Ramadan, which basically it's until April 9th.
Well, yeah,
go ahead. Well, I was just thinking, for me, this is more just long-term strategy by the Islamic world against Israel, is to keep prolonging it and wearing everybody down and gives them, you know, so constantly. So it's war, it's waging war in another way. It's propaganda war. It's other types of wars, distractions in your cities. It's keeping them in the front, and they're winning over young people, you know. So,
yeah. I mean, you know, the Islamic world. I mean, Hamas. I mean, they actually, even though they got obviously reprisals from our army, the Israeli army. I mean, they saw the 7th of October as a victory. They managed to get through into Israel and slaughter a load of people. In fact, I was reading that they actually had a second wave ready to go, and they could have got up as far as Tel Aviv if that had have got into Israel as well. If the army hadn't arrived in time, they would have gone rolled right up there and just caused more havoc. So they see this as a victory, that they managed to break, you know, and murder and kill and rape, you know, the Zionist oppressors, as they refer to us, you know.
It's amazing to me. It's quite an amazing
thing. Even though they were turned back in 1973, they saw it as a victory after the war. By virtue
after
of
the war,
they were able to cross the Barlev line. They called it a victory.
Yeah, but here we're seeing worldwide coming together. You know, they're acting in every country. Look what's going on in London. Look what's going on in America. Yeah. Look what's going on everywhere. This uprising is happening, and it's not just there. And then they're so bold as to predict more October 7ths are coming.
Yes. I mean, I'm as we said a bit earlier in before the show, I think they'll do something terrible in a UK city somewhere, in a Jewish community. Mm-hmm. You know, a van full of fertilizer, boom, in the middle of a densely populated Jewish area or something like that. I would not be surprised, because they become emboldened. They think they can get away with it now.
This is their time. And,
they believe this is their time. It's amazing to me that the think about the world's opinion of this. October 7th happened, and for just that brief moment, people went, "This is wrong against the Jewish people." Within a day, it was already changing that, no, the Palestinians are the victims, the, you know, so-called Palestinians. Gaza is the victim. Muslims are the victim. And it
all the children and Hamas killed, all the, you know, everything was going up 15%. They would just add a number, make it up, and say, this is how many mothers killed this day. And the next day, fathers killed, you know, and it was just... The way they were counting, there's no way statistically that would have been, because you have a mother killed, generally you're going to have children, you know? So it's they were making numbers up. So,
It's
brought everybody sympathy to Hamas.
Report is fact.
Yeah. And everybody goes along with it.
Yeah, it is quite amazing to me. I'm like, young people, that seed had been sown for some time. You saw it in college, you saw it in high schools, you saw it in universities, you see it now, but the seed was planted, it was there, it germinated very quickly, and now it's all over the world. And I was in Australia with Davey, and you could see the protests, you could see Jewish communities being targeted with protests. In London, I've seen pictures of London, it looks like Kabul. And then the Palestinian flags running up and down. L.A. up in the high desert here, not too far from the church. Same thing, protests, shutting down bridges, and it's becoming more and more hostile. It's becoming more hostile, and therefore now it's against Jews, it's against Christians all over the world, and this is quite a change from what we've seen the last few years. Has been ramping up. Now we're living in it. You know, the persecution of both Jews and Christians.
Yeah. And the tearing down of our societies also to rebuild. I mean, they believe they're getting ready to turn England. That I saw the commercial. Like a caliphate. Brown. I don't know if you saw that, the one on We're Brown, you know, so they're wanting to turn England brown.
Yeah. Interesting. Their thing. But another subject that's it's really interesting. It's related to this. It's here in America. You have a newspaper. Obviously, it's a media newspaper. You know, call it online. The Daily Wire, which fired a very prominent reporter commentator, Candace Owens, and the issue has become Christ is King is anti-Semitic, and it blew up very, very fast on Palm Sunday last Sunday. It was all over Twitter, X. It was all over the news. It was all over this idea within the conservative movement. Obviously, the left and the liberal media was laughing about it. They didn't care too much about it. But the idea within the conservatives is that now you have conservative Jews who are abandoning Christians who have been supportive of the Daily Wire, supportive of other organizations run by Jewish conservatives over this issue of Jesus and Bible verses that were posted. Now, it is Jesus, it is Bible verses, it is the issue, of course, of Israel. So even one of their, in the Daily Wire, what is his name? Andrew Clavin, who claims to be some kind of Christian, I'm not sure what kind he is, that says, well, you can't say Christ is King. You had other evangelical leaders saying, you can't say Christ is King because it's anti-Semitic. So we'll start with Andy here, we'll go to Jacob after that. Is Christ the King anti-Semitic now? Has it been politicized?
It sounds like it, doesn't it? I mean, that's always been the issue, hasn't it? Really, ultimately, you know, that separates, the early church separated. You know, that was the issue that separated the believers from the nation of Israel as a whole, isn't it? You know, they're the ones who accepted that Jesus is the King of the Jews, not just, and of course, the King of the world as well.
Right.
And I don't think you can equate that with anti-Semitism. It's just that's the way it went. I think with some of the later church fathers. Ran with that the wrong way, but I don't think the two are, you can say that. I mean, the two are the same thing. They're not.
Could we change the word Christ? If we change the word Christ to the to Hebrew to say Messiah, is King. Would they have would that be considered anti-Semitic? Because that's what Christ. That's what the word means. The Anointed One, the Messiah. Right. Messiah is King. Would that be anti-Semitic?
I mean, to be honest, I mean, Israel does have a historically, biblical history, a track record of rejecting those whom God has sent. You know, look at Moses, he was rejected. It just goes on. Sorry, go on.
Marco, this is the devil absolutely trying to take something with language and make further divisions within the Christian church and within Jews and trying to isolate Jews even further. And then, when people are divided, they're easier to conquer.
Absolutely, absolutely. And the reality is that, it should be witnessing to Jews, to show them who Christ is. That's the idea of evangelizing Jews. But Jacob, how do you see this? I mean, it's gotten a lot of notoriety now that even like Shmuel Bepeach.
It's not a new issue. Yeah. There is an organization I've always considered to be disgusting and reprehensible. It may have begun right, but it quickly went off the rails doctrinally and spiritually, and I would say ethically. That's the International Christian Embassy. Another was an organization called Bridges for Peace. Others were like Exobus, organizations who said they would compromise the preaching of the gospel to Jews as long as they could support Aliyah, immigration to Israel, support Zionism, support social programs in Israel. As long as they could do that, they were willing not to preach Jesus to his own people. I've always found these people to be unscriptural, and I found a lot of them to be just personally disgusting. They're just disgusting people. They have no scruples about anything. When you confront them biblically, they just can't deal with it. The lowest of the low, many of them. I even know cases where they physically attack Jewish believers in Jesus for evangelizing because they didn't want to offend the rabbis. This is what the kind of people you're talking about in some cases. Now, others support these organizations in ignorance. They understand the prophetic purposes of God for Israel and the Jews. They want to bless Israel, but they don't seem to understand that the worst way to curse a Jew is to say, I love you, Jew, go to hell without your Messiah. I'm going to withhold the way of salvation from you and let you go to hell because I love you. That's what these organizations amount to. And there's been problems with local believers, local pastors, and these organizations. Others, unfortunately, have sided with them and befriended them due to financial interests, I'm sorry to say. But let's understand it's not a new issue. I do not think that Candace Owen is an anti-Semite. I don't find anything offensive about saying Christ is king. What I would say is frame it properly. Jesus is a Jew. Jesus is a Jewish Messiah. Non-Jews and Christians believe in a Jewish figure, a Jewish book, the New Testament written by Jews. That is the way it needs to be presented. That is the way it needs delivered. You've got to emphasize the Jewishness of Jesus and the Jewishness of the origins of the Christian faith and the New Testament. Wait a minute. We're pro-Jewish. We believe in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Jesus said Jerusalem will be trampled down by the feet of the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles is completed. Jesus said he would make war against the nations who come against the Jews at the close of the age. I don't think it's been communicated well. I don't think that it's been understood well. But I don't think Candace Owen is an anti-Semite in that respect at all. What I do think, however, is her position on Gaza was not well informed. Her position on Gaza was not at all well informed. I think she was a bit out of her depth. She's a very astute woman in many respects, and I respect her for that.
I think we're having trouble with Jacob's internet. Yeah.
She's an astute woman in many respects.
Yeah. But
can you hear me?
I got a good signal from Jacob.
Okay. But
I can hear everything out.
When it came to Gaza, I think she was a bit out of her depth. A person I'm much more concerned about, who I think is anti-Semitic, is Nick Fuentes. Nick Fuentes. He is, I consider him to be a rather sinister figure. Nick Fuentes is a person who believes in the Roman Catholic equivalent, apparently, of Dominion theology. He believes in a politically Catholicized world. That's what he believes in. And he has quoted Talmudic passages that are indeed bigoted against Christians and non-Jews. But what he doesn't take into account is the Chrysostom or the Church Fathers or the polemics against the Jews of Luther, that the Jews made these kinds of statements in response to anti-Semitism coming from people professing to be on a Christian crusade against them. He does not take that into account. Neither does he take into account that the Talmudic writings also speak of the righteous Gentile and says a righteous Gentile is more righteous than a high priest on the Day of Atonement. Neither does he take into account that most Jews don't believe this stuff. in the diaspora, particularly in the United States, 50% of Jews marry non-Jews. They would not be having Jewish husbands, Jewish wives, and halakhically non-Jewish children if they hated non-Jews. Nick Fuentes is very selective in what he talks about. But Nick Fuentes has a lot of other problems. Yet he has bamboozled some people into thinking he's a conservative political figure, when in fact, he's a rather sinister, if not dangerous, figure.
I just add something about, I'm going back to the Christian embassy. What people maybe not be aware of is that very early on, in fact, even before it was founded, I think it was Jan Willem van der Hoeven.
Yes.
I read an article he wrote before that actually was the embassy was founded. And, you know, he was talking about, unity of the body and the end times and everything. And then that when this unity came about, he was expecting this kind of outpouring, a massive outpouring of the Holy Spirit, which would usher in the return of Christ and things like that. But he was quoting, I'm not quoting it very well, but I don't remember it exactly word for word. But what he was quoting, and he writes it underneath, as brother, the Feast of Tabernacle, George Warnock.
Yes.
Of course, Latter Rain. It was a Latter Rain. The whole basis of the ICIEJ originally was founded on a vision originally of George Warnock, the Latter.
Interesting.
And of course, now you can see that's why it's been so flaky that years. Although Jürgen Buhler, who's the current director, he's Apostle Jürgen Buhler.
the
hand in hand with the NAR and everything as well. It's been corrupt from the very beginning.
When Morris Cirillo went on TV in Britain on the Dispatches program and said, and it showed him saying, send £10 British and see two Jews saved. And as an added bonus, two members of your family will be born again. And this was put on TV on the Dispatches program in Britain. Well, van der Hoeven, John Willem, teamed up with Cirillo, spoke at Cirillo's Pentecostal conference in Europe, and said Isaiah 40, he completely distorted the text out of context and says, we're only called to comfort the Jews, not to preach the gospel to them. Malcolm Heading, his successor, has made statements that were nothing short of heretical. Nothing short of heretical. Whoa. It's a disgusting organization. It is not the embassy of Christ. Paul makes it clear to those who preach Christ who are his ambassadors. There is nothing.
Yep.
The International Christian Embassy, I do not see how we can scripturally consider it to be either Christian or an embassy. And it's not the only one like that.
You know, one guy who's really taken advantage of all this, it's Shmuley Batea, jumps into the fray. He's definitely anti-Christians, definitely anti-Jesus. And he comes out to the defense, of course, of the conservative Jews. And he says, no, it's Candace Owens who paints us as evil Jewish. And he calls them Jewish pigs. He says, we're going to drink Christian blood. And he dresses up in Purim. For Purim, he dresses up with the pig snout and drinking, what it seems. It's just a red cup, supposed to be Christian blood. But again, it's this whole thing that Batek squabbles over this, that yes, these Christians, he says, are anti-Semitic. Andrew Clavin says, if you say Christ is king, you're being anti-Semitic. That's too hard. That's too much. And then again, there's the division. There's a division right there. Go ahead, Jake.
Marco, to your point with Andrew Clavin, especially Andrew Clavin, remember what he said in his video. He says that basically Ben Shapiro has a special dispensation from God to be Jewish.
Oh, yeah.
And that he would definitely destroy his whole family if he became Christian. Well, the word tells us he who loves father, mother, daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And then on top of that, you talk about what Andrew Clavin, what Ben Shapiro, and what Jeremy Boring are saying. What are they saying? You know, they're saying exactly what Caiaphas said. How dare you, Pontius Pilate, write Jesus is the king of the Jews. You need to rewrite it and say he was
he said
he was the king of the Jews.
Yeah.
So, yeah,
I mean, they're parroting something that is ancient.
It already happened.
Saying, if Ben Shapiro, it's God's will that Ben Shapiro rejects his own Messiah as the Messiah. And nobody comes to the Father but through me. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. There's no other salvation in any other name. No, it's God's will that Ben Shapiro should go to hell. That's what Klavan's basically saying.
That is exactly what Klavan said.
Exactly. Keep Jesus out of Shapiro's mind.
And I would love to hear what Shapiro, Klavan, and Boring have to say about Allahu Akbar. Is that anti-Semitic, guys?
Oh, man. That would be the quintessential anti-Semitic. But that's, you know what? This is, I think, to David's point, it's the devil. What an opportunity, isn't it? The devil's trying to keep the gospel away from the Jews by making this this politicized, instead of, using, and I think we got to take the opportunity, because what's trending right now among the conservative views, among liberals who are wondering what is going on with this Christ as the King, we got to use it as an opportunity to witness to the Jews, as Jacob pointed it out. Look, we believe in the Messiah. The Messiah is Jesus Christ. He is the King of the Jews. He's the King of all of us, and we need to, receive him, repent and believe of our, of our sins and repent and believe in him. That's what we ought to be doing. But, I think Christians to take that opportunity to cause them to be jealous. How do we know more about Jesus being a Jewish Messiah than they do? But that is, but
we got to get them to read. I'm sorry. Sorry.
Go ahead.
We got to get them to read Isaiah 53.
Oh, absolutely. And Daniel 9 and Daniel,
It's there.
I want to finish off our episode real quick with something that came out this week. And it was another controversial thing, but it involves a Christian evangelical leader. This is the raid of Sean Combs, Nicole Diddy, his two houses, one in L.A., one in Miami. Homeland Security raided it and under investigation for sex trafficking, two separate jurisdictions, two separate warrants, all that. And but what's interesting, there's five lawsuits. In one of the lawsuits, a Christian leader is mentioned, and his name is T.D. Jakes. T.D. Jakes is mentioned in the lawsuit by Rodney Jones, who basically accuses Combs of, participating in sex trafficking ventures. This is five different lawsuits, one by his ex-girlfriend. And this renowned pastor, T.D. Jakes from Dallas, is named in the lawsuit. In fact, what Jones says is that in what the other lawsuit said, and in which T.D. Jakes wasn't mentioned in that, but it was mentioned that by the accuser, that T.D. Jakes had been attending sex parties. Now, I don't know if it's true. I don't know what happened. I have no idea if he did or not. But T.D. Jakes had a propensity, another in the past, of being involved in some kind of sexual scandal. Now, tremendous consequences. I'll start with Jacob there here. Jacob, the lawsuit says that Jones has irrefutable evidence. I don't know what that means exactly, what kind of evidence he has about Jakes, about Combs, about the relationship there. We know that they were very close. We know that T.D. Jakes spoke at Sean Combs, media channel, in which he preached his sermons. And now this comes down on Combs. It looks like everybody's coming down on the sexual allegations and trafficking, and he's going to name names. What's your take on this? This is pretty heavy stuff.
This is not the first time there's been allegations of sexual immorality concerning T.D. Jakes, who is a heretic. He's oneness. He is Sabellian, essentially. He's certainly money-oriented in the opinion of many people. He teaches that he's a false teacher, but this is not the first allegation. If the evidence is there, I hope it is brought to light. I hope it is brought to light. But even if it is, his diehard followers will still continue to be supportive of him, more than likely. Even Jim Baker is still in business. Now, I hope it is brought out. What is also interesting is, with the Epstein scandal, you had Prince Andrew become destroyed as any kind of a public figure, and he brought tremendous reproach upon the royal family and the monarchy. Now, allegedly, Prince Harry is also alleged to be somehow accessory to some of these sexual sexual events that were of not only morally improper nature, but possibly legally, legal liabilities and criminal liabilities. I don't know. Seems to run in the family if it's proved to be true. But I am not in the least bit surprised about T.D. Jakes. It is not the first time. Just at this time, the evidence may be there. But my problem with him is not his immorality if it's true. My problem with him is that he's a heretic and a false teacher.
That's right.
David, what do you think, David?
Well, I wanted to tie Candace Owens into this because she was exposing P. Diddy and his blackmail in all this. She was exposing him that he had this evidence and everything. And so that's pretty interesting. But she was also going after Macron and his
husband, wife.
I don't know that he's actually a man. So that may be one reason why they're trying to bring her down too. So when you start attacking world leaders that are part of the World Economic Forum, they make another problem. So, but look, T.D. Jakes has long been in trouble with the earliest I remember was abuse of women in his own church. And then later there was allegations of homosexuality.
That's right. And
so now being in an orgy, well, it's becoming a pattern. Now, he may think he's okay. He may think he's good with God. He may think all he has to do is just repent and it's all behind him. But, you know, it says he has to be above reproach. And now, like Jacob said correctly, these false teachers, they never go away. But what does happen is their dollars don't go quite as high anymore. They kind of trend downwards for a while.
You know, it's interesting you brought that up, David, on his video, the video that we watched from December, where he was mentioned in a lawsuit by Sean Combs' ex-girlfriend. And they were talking about his visitations to these homes, T.D. Jakes' homes, and Sean Diddy's homes, but T.D. Jakes visited them where they had these sexual orgies. And he says, I'm good. Nothing happens. The worst that could happen, if everything is true, he says, all I have to do is repent because the blood of Jesus covers me.
Boy.
There's enough power, and I don't care what it is, the blood's going to fix it. Now, Jacob,
but he's got a different Jesus there, Mark.
With Sabellianism. Jacob, explain that to me. You brought up a good point when we watched it. You know, is he coming out and saying it, preempting it and saying, well, it may be true, maybe not true, but just in case.
The very thing that Hebrews and Peter warn about, spurning the blood. They treat the blood of Jesus as a credit card. It doesn't matter what I do, I'll just put it on my charge card and Jesus will pick up the bill. In fact, he's already paid for it on the cross. That is a distortion of the truth. You know, his blood was shed to forgive our sin, to atone for our sin, but that we would stop sinning. It is not a permit to continue doing it. This is licentiousness. Mm. That is what he's teaching, licentiousness. It is a variation or a differently phrased version of the beliefs of Joseph Prince in Singapore, hyper-grace.
Yeah.
Hyper-grace false teaching using different terminology than Joseph Prince does, but it amounts to the same thing.
Mm-hmm. Elon had said during that time, he brought up the verse, you know, about shall we go on sinning? Yeah. God forbid.
We continue in sin that grace by abound.
And you know, this is the interesting thing about T.D. Jakes. You know, not only as a false teacher, as a heretic, as Jacob was reminding us of it, of course, is true, the Sabellianism, but his influence on another pastors, put it that way. You have guys like Furtick, who says, my favorite pastor, my favorite preacher is T.D. Jakes. You have some Calvary Chapel guys who look up to T.D. Jakes as a major Christian. Yeah. And Luke, was that?
Hillsong did. Brian Houston did. With Hillsong.
Brian Houston. Yeah. Now, notice the sex scandals with Brian Houston. Notice the sex scandals with Mike Bickle, the T.D. Jakes. Yeah. it just seems like these guys, it's just, oh man, God is opening the door, opening the eyes of people to see these guys were really not Christian pastors in the sense of true Christian pastors. They're absolute false teachers and heretics. Go ahead, Andy.
But yeah, I was going to say something, you know, but all of these sex scandals, it's like, you know, a couple of years ago, of course, you know, remember Todd Bentley, how he was exposed. But the fact is, you know, and only then with the charismatic movement on the whole, oh, you know, he's a false teacher. No, he's always been a false teacher, just like T.D. Jakes, just like Mike Bickle. Mike Bickle was coming out with crazy stuff 30 years ago or more.
Yeah.
You know, you could tell straight off that he was, you know, if you had any discernment about you, that he was a flake, that he was a heretic. Yes. I mean, it's going back. I mean, you know, Mike Bickle was all part and parcel with Bob Jones. Yes. You can't get a more nutty so-called prophet than Bob Jones. But, you know, I mean, even after Bob Jones was caught, you know, with that whole scandal with him watching women undress in front of him so he could prophesy over them and everything, even before all that, you know, he was wacky. But, you know, but over here, you know, we have this, I probably mentioned them before, you know, we have this Tikkun apostolic group, you know, run by Apostle Jan Juster, Asher Intrater, Eitan Shishkov, and, you know, and connected with people like Ron Cantor and all the rest of it, the head of God TV Israel. But, you know, Jan Juster, even after Bob Jones was disgraced because of his sexual misconduct, he was still regarding him as a prophet.
Yep.
You know, there's this whole idea that you can, I mean, you know, it's crazy, you know.
They were calling Bickle, you know, like guys like, who was it? Michael Brown, relationship with Mike Bickle. Now he's trying to distance himself from him.
Yeah.
You know, other guys were claiming Mike Bickle was the man of the hour.
Yep. And you remember Todd Bentley was the first of the new breed. That's why they had to rehab him, because they all came out on that stage and, you know, promised him as the first of the new breed.
Yeah, rehab them.
Now you've got all these other
false teachings, it's sexual scandals, money scandals, exactly what Second Peter warned about, isn't it?
One of the things that stands at the root of a lot of this, I mean, there's all the doctrinal issues as well, but one of the main things is this idea that you can prophesy falsely, you can make false predictions, and yet still be a genuine prophet.
That was John Wimber. That was John Wimber. He crystallized that kind of thinking.
Yeah.
Yeah, but Rick Joyner used to say the same thing in his book. Rick Joyner talked about you could be, you know, 40% right and grow in your ministry as a prophet and get it, you know, 45%, 50% right. Man, and people still believe that.
As you get, as we get closer and closer to the return of Christ, our prophecies will get better, like 90%, 95%. And then right before he comes, then we're going to be 100% when he comes.
They used to quote that verse from Paul that we prophesy in part. It's not total.
Yeah, I think Asher Intrater was coming out with that very phrase. I think it was Asher Intrater. It was either him or Ron Cantor about prophesying. No, it was Asher Intrater about prophesying in part means we don't have to be 100% accurate.
Yeah.
You know, Andy, real quick, just in case.
We were talking about these people 35, 40 years ago. From 30 or 40 years ago, and they're still getting away with it. Yep. Jacob was talking about it. I was talking about it. You know, and it just amazes me. They fall for a day or two, and then they get propped back up because the money starts coming.
There is a market for them. There's a market for them still.
Right.
Andrew, real quick, can you tell us Asher Intrater and Ron Cantor? So people don't know, and I don't want to assume any.
Yeah, over here, there's it's changed its names a few times, but you had it's now called Tikkun Global, and I think you'll find them if you look it up on the internet, you'll find them, and then you've got the senior apostle Daniel Juster, who's been very influential. He was head of the was it the Union of Messianic Jewish Synagogue Assemblies or something, a few some years back. Daniel Just, Asher Intrator, who's considered to be the prophetic sort of voice of Eitan Shishkov, they've been working together for years. They were very involved, first of all, in the States together, and then Intrator and Shishkov came over here in the early 90s. It's a completely pernicious...
Yeah.
They've done so much damage.
Essentially, what they are is, essentially, I think, Andy, would you agree that they're essentially the hyper-messianic version of the NAR? Of the New Apostolic Reformation.
Well, they're not a very big group as an apostolic network, but they are very well connected with other senior NAR figures. They're in covenant with Che Arn,
yes,
for example. That's just one of them.
Crazy guy.
Yeah, I mean,
Elon, do you have some papers in English people, if they're interested, could read up on the website?
I think I might have some stuff somewhere. I wrote some stuff some years ago, and I've got a whole archive of some of their movies and short films and things and teachings somewhere. I mean, there's a huge amount of it, but they are very much of the NAR. They're a messianic NAR group, yeah, basically. Absolutely. Really.
Didn't you have a list
on your YouTube channel?
Yes, Andy, I do. And I, in fact, the last list that was out of all the organizations and congregations over here that had been connected or influenced by the NAR, it's been put up on Twitter actually now. But you can also find it on archive.org. I'll send the link to Marco. But it's a few years old now, but it's quite an extensive list.
Yeah, send it to Jay.
Is that on Moriel's Twitter account?
No, it's I'll tell you what, I'll send it to Jay in a few minutes. I'll send it to him and he can put it on the feed or whatever, the chat feed or something. I mean, when you see how many organizations and congregations in Israel alone. And this is not even a complete and exhaustive list. I were touched by NAR teachings. It's huge.
Yes.
Yeah. It's riddled the body over here, and it caused a terrible fracture a couple of years ago. As people started to find out about this stuff, it really came to a head in 2022 when there was a motion to try and throw some of these and condemn Tikkun's doctrine at the kind of the national level. Among kind of believers, and it got thrown out. So the body voted in favor of the heretics, basically.
Yeah, is that the sad thing?
They bring in a lot of money, don't they?
Yes, huge.
They bring a lot of money in, and it's going to the wrong places, isn't it?
I would say so. Yes. Yeah. I mean. You've got organizations like Mar-O's, for example. They're huge money raisers, and they're very influential. And a lot of pastors and people and ministries they sometimes get money through NAR sources.
That's right.
Without knowing entirely that they are.
Mar-O's is also aligned with Morris Cirillo.
He was, Morris Cirillo is now gone to his reward, isn't he?
That was the Sakharams. The other thing is, I once actually heard a recording of the leaders of the Tikkun movement, and they were actually saying that as the apostles met in Acts 15 and issued decisions concerning the circumcision of Gentiles, that based on geography, and based on Jewish and Israeli identity as believers, that they need to get back to having that kind of authority over the body of Christ.
Yeah. Yes, that's it. Yeah. They call that the Boaz Revelation. The Boaz Revelation, they call it. As Ruth, the Gentile Ruth, submitted to Boaz So they are the Boaz, and the Gentile church must submit to the authority of the restored Messianic remnant.
But yeah, Jacob, in Acts 15, wasn't the Holy Spirit in agreement with them?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know if the Holy Spirit's in agreement with these guys. No, in fact, I'm sure he isn't.
Yeah, I'm sure. Hey, Andy, real quick before we finish, we got to finish the episode and jump into backstage. Can you let us know your YouTube channel? Because you got some videos.
No, it's only a little one. It's I've got the. Can I send you the URL for it? Or
yeah,
just mention the name of it. We'll put it up.
It's just a little play. It's called. Yeah. I think it's called Because Doctrine Matters. I think that's what I called it. Yeah, okay, yeah. You'll find it there. It's got the icon is.
We talked about your videos before, and
I've done one mentioning Ron Cantor. I mean, he's not on my list of favorite people. I mean, the clip with him with Patricia King is hysterical. Oh my goodness.
Yeah, just to have just so people can go to a YouTube channel and watch the video. We have your rapture videos that you talked about before, and those were very good, well received. So we want to make sure that people remember Because Doctrine Matters. That's YouTube channel for
Andy. I'm on Twitter as well, under the same thing, under the same handle, I think.
Yeah, Because Doctrine Matters. Absolutely.
Jay, I was going to send you something. What was I going to send you again? The URL for that list. Yeah. Sorry. Right. Okay.
No problem. All right. Well, let's conclude catching up here, and we're going to jump into backstage. So you can't miss backstage, because if you liked what we talked about earlier, T.D. Jakes, Crisis King, Candace Owens, Mula Boteach, all the war stuff, attack on Israel, attack on the Jews, more stuff, postmillennialism. Don't want to miss it. Backstage, not on YouTube, not on Facebook. Jump to the other ones. We got questions for Jacob. We got questions for Andy. We got questions for David. Anybody else wants to answer that? We'll see you in a few minutes.
Hello, and thank you for watching Moriel TV. There are so many things that are happening at Moriel Ministries worldwide, from the Philippines to Japan to India to Africa and back to Europe and the United States. So many of our brothers and sisters are spreading the good news of Jesus Christ to this lost world. We are so thankful for your prayers. God has been faithful and has blessed us in so many ways. If you'd like to partner with our efforts abroad and at home, please take a moment to click the link in the description and help us as the Lord leads you. Thank you very much, and God bless.